Howdy folks, and welcome to Tankfest 2016 at the Bovington Tank Museum. This is my third Tankfest in 4 years. Unfortunately, I had to miss Tankfest 2 years ago because it fell at the same date as the air show in Dayton, Ohio. And, well, yeah, that was really a tough choice to make. But I didn't have to make any kind of choice this year because I was completely free for Tankfest 2016. And in my opinion, this has been the best Tankfest so far. And it was completely sold out. The Saturday, sold out months in advance. The Sunday, sold out just over a week before the event itself. And when you see the kind of display that they put on for the visitors, it's not hard to see why, and I have plenty of video footage of exactly that sort of thing to share with you in today's video. I actually went down to Tankfest the day before for a community contributor day on behalf of Wargaming.net, who were the main sponsors once again of Tankfest. We got the opportunity to rub shoulders with some of the familiar old faces like Circumflexes, Quickie Baby, Pointy Head Jedi, Maxwell, and some of the more up-and-coming community contributors who also play World of Tanks on platforms other than the PC, like the Beard guys who play on the consoles. And you have to admit that whether you play World of Tanks or not, having a kind of partnership like this with the Tank Museum can be nothing but good news for the Tank Museum, because if only 10% of the people who play World of Tanks pick up a book afterwards and start reading about the subject matter, well, that can only be a good thing. We were lucky enough to get a guided tour of the museum by the director, Richard Smith, who always has some amusing stories to tell, and in particular likes to take people around the back of the T-34 just to demonstrate that, well, you won't find two armour welds that match, and in some cases you can even get your finger between some of the gaps, and yet the T-34 did the job. It was good enough. If you build a beautiful tank in Russia, you get punished for wasting resources. On the other hand, the Panther, just across the hall from the T-34-85, is a machine of beauty and grace and superb craftsmanship, which was a bit of a waste considering how long they actually lasted in battle. Interestingly, the Panther that they have at the Bovington Tank Museum is actually British built. The factory that was constructing them was captured, and the British basically turned the handle a few times to see what would come out at the other end. But they added their own finishing touches, which Richard was only too keen to point out to us.
This chain is a British chain. If you look at how this chain is made, there's all the cameras going to have to zoom in. This is made of twisted metal. You can make this with a train gorilla, it's fine. It does a job, adequate, it's good enough. British chain. Now, if you're entering a chain into a chain making competition, and you wanted to give your winning chain to your girlfriend as a Christmas present, you wouldn't give her that chain. You would give her this chain, which is a German chain. And on the German chain, everything is individually welded. It's a beautiful chain. But you can guarantee, given the technology world, no one wrote a requirement specification saying how the chain needed to be made. Everyone knows you have to do a chain properly. And that's what it properly looks like. It does the same job, trained welder, trained gorilla, the Germans lose the Second World War.
After the guided tour, it was off for lunch, where we managed to get a sneak preview of one of the highlights of the following day's armour displays in the arena, the visiting Leopard 2 from the Dutch Army Museum. Sadly, the Dutch no longer operate Leopard 2s or main battle tanks of any shape, size, or variety, but they managed to save one for the museum, and this is the first time I've ever seen a Leopard 2 up close and personal, and it really is one hell of a sexy beast of a tank. And then the following day, the Saturday, was back for Tankfest itself, and I spent most of Saturday just standing in the press area with a grandstand view of all of these military vehicles as they thundered around the arena at speed doing their things, and also called the battle reenactment at the end of the day, and had a fantastic view of it. And I do plan to be doing a minimum of talking throughout the course of this video, because I want to turn the volume up so you can hear these machines as they thunder around the arena, as God intended. Beginning with the British Army Jackal 2, which is used for reconnaissance, rapid assault, fire support, and convoy protection. It has an endurance of 800 kilometers, maximum speed of 80 miles per hour. It's 129 kilometers per hour on roads, or 55 miles per hour, 89 kilometers per hour over rough terrain. And unusually for a wheeled vehicle, it's actually quite capable of crossing some very, very rough terrain, thanks to the airbag suspension system. It's armed with a general purpose machine gun up front, and the ring at the top of the vehicle, which was moved forward to allow full 360 degree arcs of fire, can be either armed with a heavy machine gun or an automatic grenade launcher. The Jackal was then joined in the arena by the British Army Scimitar II, the upgraded version of the British Army Scimitar, featuring increased crew protection against mine blasts. The seats for the three-man crew are actually suspended from the ceiling, so that if a mine goes off underneath the vehicle, the crew's feet aren't going to be in contact with the floor, and therefore have the shock of the blast transferred straight up through their legs, wrecking their ankles and their knees. It also has cage armour at the sides and front and rear to protect against shaped charge attacks typically associated with rock-repelled grenades. Its 235 horsepower 5.9 litre diesel engine gives it a top speed of 80 kilometres per hour, and it's armed with a 7.62mm general purpose machine gun, multiple 66mm smoke grenade discharges, and a Rodden L21 automatic cannon which is capable of firing 90 rounds per minute. Like all British Army armoured vehicles, it's equipped with a forced air system which allows the crew to seal up in the event of chemical, bacteriological or radiological attack, which also therefore necessitated the implementation of the famous boiling vessel in all British Army armoured vehicles, which allows the crew to cook food and, more importantly, brew a nice hot cup of tea inside the safety of their tank. The next armoured vehicle to strut its funky stuff in the arena was the Titan Armoured Bridge Layer, rated by MilitaryToday.com as the fastest and most heavily armoured bridge layer in the world, which, when you consider that it's basically a Challenger 2 with a hydraulic bridge on top, is not particularly surprising. The Titan carries and lays the current range of British Army close support bridges, which are part of what's known as the Modular Bridging System. It can carry one 26-metre long bridge or two 12-metre long bridges, and it can lay multiple combination bridges. It launches a single 26-metre long bridge in less than 2 minutes. 12-metre long bridges can be laid in only 90 seconds. They can carry the heaviest main battle tanks in the world, and once the bridge has been crossed, it's picked up by Titan so it can use it again later. And yes, Titan did just throw one of the rubber covers for its road wheels, and yes, somebody is probably going to get a real bollocking when that thing gets back to the barracks. Titan's powered by a Perkins CV12 diesel turbocharged 1200 horsepower engine. At the front, Titan can also be fitted with a dozer blade or a mine plough, making it one of the Royal Engineers' most versatile vehicles. Next up, we have the Terrier, which is a general support combat engineering vehicle. It's intended for battlefield preparation. Typical tasks include route clearance, digging anti-tank ditches, digging defensive positions for troops or other armored vehicles. This Terrier is carrying a fascine on top, which is basically a bunch of rods or plastic pipes which are bound together and used for filling in other obstacles to allow other vehicles to cross, and can also be used for strengthening the sides of embankments, ditches and trenches. As the Terrier rockets past in the background, you can see the Titan doing its stuff there, laying a 26-metre long bridge, which it can do in 2 minutes, and which is capable of carrying the heaviest armoured vehicles in the world. Another view of the Terrier there from the other side, you can see the manipulator arm, which can carry a load of 3 tons. And coming up next, we can see the Royal Engineers Trojan. Now, the Trojan performs more or less the same tasks as the Terrier. Well, if that's the case, Jingles, why do you need the Trojan? Well, whereas the Terrier operates in the indirect fire area of the battlefield, i.e. someplace nice and safe where it's not getting shot at directly because it doesn't have the armour protection, the Trojan, like the Titan, is based on the Challenger 2, and its primary mission is to clear minefields, if necessary, while under fire. Anywhere you can take a Challenger 2, you can take a Trojan, which allows the Trojan, unlike the Terrier, to provide direct battlefield combat and engineering logistics support to the British Army's Challenger 2 fleet. I'm just going to shut up for a minute here and crank the volume up so you can hear this thing rumbling around the arena with that massive 1200 horsepower diesel engine. Yeah, I know, it is, isn't it? Anyway, next up we have the Stormer, which is a further development of the CVRT family of track vehicles, such as the Scimitar and the Scorpion. The Stormer is intended for a wide variety of roles. It can be fitted with a two-man 25mm cannon-armed turret. It can be used as an ambulance, a logistics vehicle, a mine clearer, a bridge layer, or in this case, an air defense vehicle. It's equipped with a Starstreak short-range air defense missile system. The Starstreak high-velocity missile system is primarily intended to defend vehicles against the attack helicopter threat. The missiles can be either fired from the launcher and on the top of the vehicle, or can be individually demounted and fired from the shoulder. Each missile fires three darts, which can ensure multiple hits on the target, and each dart is equipped with a high explosive warhead. And then it was time to wheel out the seriously big guns. This is the AS-90 self-propelled gun. It equips three field regiments of the Royal Horse Artillery and the Royal Artillery. It's fitted with a 39-caliber 155mm gun. And during trials, two AS-90s were able to deliver a total payload of 261 kilos of high explosives onto a single target in less than 10 seconds. The automated loading system allows the gun to fire with a burst rate of fire of 3 rounds in less than 10 seconds, an intense rate of fire of 6 rounds a minute for 3 minutes, and a sustained rate of fire of 2 rounds a minute. The gun's computerized fire control system allows the gun to fire 3 shots at different trajectories, which are all capable of impacting on the target at the same time, in effect turning a single AS-90 into the equivalent of a battery of artillery. Unfortunately, because it's British, on the way out of the arena, the AS-90 broke down. Well, it didn't really, but they simulated it in order to demonstrate the use of the Challenger Armoured Repair and Recovery Vehicle. It's currently the most powerful armoured recovery vehicle of its class in the world. It's based on the Challenger 1 main battle tank, and instead of a turret and a gun, it's fitted with a winch, a crane, a front-mounted dozer blade, has an all-welded superstructure added to the top of the vehicle. Typical tasks include, well, exactly this, recovery of damaged or overturned armoured vehicles on the battlefield. It can also provide maintenance service in situ, or tow the vehicle to assembly points or maintenance units. They're usually used on the front line, where there are no fixed repair or overhaul facilities. It has a winching capacity of 52 tons, and with the help of pulley blocks, the traction force of the winch is increased to 104 tons. It also has an auxiliary winch, which is typically used for replacing the power pack in Challenger 1 and now Challenger 2 main battle tanks. It has a crew of 3, but there's also space inside to recover the crew of any vehicles which it has to assist. And while the Karav is doing its stuff to the AS-90, let's take a look at another British armoured fighting vehicle. Although if we're going to be completely accurate, this is a variant of another British armoured fighting vehicle. At first glance, it looks just like the Warrior infantry fighting vehicle, and, well, at one point it was, but this is the Royal Electrical and Mechanical Engineers version of the Warrior. It's the FV-512 Mechanized Combat Repair Vehicle, operated by Remy detachments in armoured infantry battalions. It has a 6.5-ton crane and can carry a trailer which carries 2 Warrior power packs or 1 Challenger power pack, and wouldn't be used to recover a vehicle the size of the AS-90 here or a main battle tank, but is used to recover and repair smaller armoured fighting vehicles and armoured personnel carriers. Speaking of which, it looks like the boys in the Challenger armoured recovery vehicle are about ready to start fitting the A-frame to the rear of the AS-90 and will soon be taking it under tow and escorting it out of the arena. So while they're doing that, again, I'm just going to shut up for a minute so we can listen to the engine of this Warrior as it thunders past. Well, it looks like the boys in the Challenger recovery vehicle have just about got the situation under hand and are ready to rock and roll. You can see the crew resuming their positions and just connecting up their internal comms. So any second now, this thing should be ready to fire her up and get that AS-90 back to the vehicle park where it belongs. So, let's just watch them do it. That AS-90 weighs 45 tons, by the way. Well, that's great, Jingles, but I came to see Tankfest, not Tractorfest. Where are the actual tanks? Oh, don't worry. We've got your tanks right here. The British Army Challenger 2. Definitely not the quietest main battle tank in the world, and it's not the fastest either, but it's incredibly reliable, unlike its predecessor, the Chieftain, and it's probably the best armoured. It's also got a ridiculously good gun. Challenger 2 holds the record for the longest distance tank-on-tank kill in history. The effective firing range of the gun with armour-piercing discarding Sabo ammunition is well over 3,000 metres, and during the Gulf War it defeated an Iraqi T-72 at a range of 4 kilometres. Challenger 2 is a 62-ton tank propelled by a Perkins CV-12 turbocharged 1200 horsepower diesel engine, and while it is definitely not the fastest main battle tank in its class, it still manages a very respectable road speed of 56 kilometres per hour and has enough fuel capacity to keep the tank running for 500 kilometres before it needs to refuel. It can handle a gradient of 60 degrees, it can handle a side slope of 30 degrees, the gun can depress to an angle of minus 10 and elevate to an angle of plus 20 degrees. The Challenger 2 is a great tank. Unfortunately, it's becoming a bit of an old tank, and in the finest traditions of the British government, we've left it a little bit late to do anything about it. And so the Challenger 2 life extension program, which involves fitting a smoothbore 120mm gun and redesigning the turret for it, has been handed over to the Germans. Because if you want something done properly, get the Germans to do it. And oh dear, Britain just voted to leave Europe, didn't it? Oh well. Well, that should make things interesting. At the very least, it's almost guaranteed to make it significantly more expensive than the £700 million which have been so far earmarked to the Germans for the project. Yes, that is the British Army Warrior Infantry Fighting Vehicle. The proper version this time, not the combat recovery vehicle operated by the Royal Electrical and Mechanical Engineers that we saw earlier. The Warrior is a very, very good infantry fighting vehicle. Unfortunately, like Challenger 2, it's also starting to get a little bit long in the tooth. Warrior was first produced in 1986, and they finished producing them in 1995, and the British Army intends to keep operating them until 2035. Which means that, well, even the very newest British Army Warrior infantry fighting vehicle, by the time it's retired from service, is going to be a minimum of 40 years old. That'd be like taking M4 Shermans to the Gulf War. Nevertheless, I do have supreme confidence that the British government has a firm grip on the kind of threats that the British Army is likely to be facing 20 years from now, and that kind of short-sighted, penny-pinching decision-making is not going to come back and bite some poor infantryman in the arse 20 years from now. Yeah, right. Well, anyway, the British Army display concluded on the morning of the first day of Tankfest with a demonstration of an assault on a defended position. Luckily for the British Army, they didn't have to attack anybody armed with anything more sophisticated than a bunch of AK-47s, so it all went rather well. And once again, I'm going to shut my big mouth and let you just enjoy the show as it unfolds. And with those nasty AK-47 wielding Johnny foreigners firmly shown the errors of their ways, the British Army display team concluded with a circuit of the arena, joined by a special guest, the Dutch Army Leopard 2. British Army finished showing off in the arena, accompanied this year for the first time by their special guests from the Netherlands. Let's not forget that 2016 is the 100th anniversary of the tank's first use in battle in World War I. And while the Tank Museum does have an event planned to celebrate this later on in the year, they couldn't let Tankfest go without at least giving us a teaser of what they had in store in the future. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, the Mark IV tank. Veteran of the First World War, 100 years old today. Now, don't get too excited. This isn't an actual World War I veteran Mark IV tank. This is the replica that the Tank Museum have. They do have lots and lots of First World War vintage tanks, including one theoretically operational Mark IV tank. However, as I'm sure you can understand, they don't want to risk ruining it by taking it out and actually running it. So for events like this, they've got the replica, which is an amazing replica, you have to admit. I do understand that the history of the Mark IV in operational condition that the Tank Museum have is actually quite amusing. It was originally called Excellent, named after HMS Excellent, the Royal Naval Gunnery School at Whale Island in Portsmouth, which is where the crews of the original World War I tanks were sent for gunnery training. It was actually reactivated in 1940 in World War II, where it was sent off for service with the Home Guard. Unfortunately, its service didn't last very long, as it was decommissioned after wrecking too many cars while driving through the streets of Portsmouth to get to its Home Guard detachment. And that tank is owned by the Tank Museum and is theoretically capable of running. As I understand it, there is one other World War I veteran Mark IV tank that's still theoretically capable of being made to run, and it's held at Fort Benning in Georgia in the USA. But it is in very, very poor condition and is going to require extensive restoration before it can be made to run even half as well as this replica Mark IV. But it would be fantastic if they could get the old girl up and running again one day. Next up, and the final event of the day that I was able to record before being dragged off to do something for Wargaming, was the World War II historical battle reenactment, which was loosely based around events in Tunisia in 1943, leading up to the capture of Tiger 131. And I do mean very, very loosely based on events in Tunisia in 1943. There were primarily lots of Shermans, Stuarts, half-tracks, and I'd seen some of these vehicles before, and some of the reenactors before as well, because a lot of them also took part in the Omer and Embarkation event last week, also here in Dorset. The Tank Museum, of course, wasted no time getting Fury out and rolling around for the crowd, and it was nice to see that some of the Shermans were crewed by British tank crew reenactors, and the surprise guest, as far as I'm concerned, was the Hellcat. I have never seen one before, and wow, it's awesome. Interesting little fact about the Hellcat, which I wasn't aware of until somebody pointed out to me at Tankfest this year, was that because it used a radial aircraft engine, if the vehicle was left overnight, all of the oil in the engine would settle to the bottom. So if you didn't want the machine to seize up when you started it up the next morning, you quite literally had to turn the engine over, which apparently is where the expression "turn the engine over" comes from. Didn't know that. Also, something else I hadn't noticed until somebody pointed it out to me, note the British Sherman tank crews. They don't wear helmets. Seems a bit brave of them. I mean, I've been inside a couple of tanks, and when those things rattle around at speed over rough terrain, you want to be wearing a helmet, yet British tank crews didn't. Well, we were then treated to a brief display of some moving Russian and German equipment, and I'm not entirely sure whether or not this Polish T-34-85 was intentionally trying to lay a smokescreen. Well, the engine was just that bad, but, well, there it is. You certainly knew when that thing had driven past. And there goes the Panzer III, with the long-barreled 50mm gun, closely followed, of course, by the star of every tank fest, Tiger 131. 70 years old and still just as good-looking as the day she rolled off the assembly line. And it is not a cheap process to get a tank as old as this looking and sounding and performing as well as the Tank Museum have managed with Tiger 131. And that is only possible thanks to your donations. Remember, the Tank Museum's a charity, and as long as you guys keep coming along to Tank Fest and you keep coming to Tiger Day and you keep visiting the museum, hopefully one day we'll see Tiger 1 squaring off against the Leopard 3. Hey, you never know. Right, who fancies a fight? The battle reenactment that you're about to see actually features not that much involvement from the Tank Museum itself. Obviously, you can see the fury being run out here, but most of the vehicles are privately owned, and certainly all of the reenactors reenacting the British, American, and German troops have no direct involvement with the Tank Museum, so I have to give a special shout out to all of the reenactors and all of the private military vehicle owners that made the final event on each day of Tankfest 2016 as special as they did. And here they are. I actually saw a lot of these guys at the Armour and Embarkation event, also in Dorset, the week before Tankfest. It was the third one that they've been running, and they're probably not going to be doing it again because it is ridiculously expensive. The fuel costs alone ran as far as £18,000, but I'm at least glad I got the opportunity to take part at least once before they finally knocked it on the head. This Jeep, for example, the armored Jeep with the M2 50 caliber machine gun on top, was one of the vehicles that was present at Armour and Embarkation, as were most of the half tracks that you're going to see. And I recognised a couple of faces from the American reenactors as well, one in particular. I never got to know his name. He was riding the M20 Greyhound that was in convoy ahead of us in our M20 Greyhound command vehicle. We just called him George Takei Jr. because he bore a stunning resemblance to a very, very young Star Trek original series era George Takei, who played Lieutenant Sulu. And everybody knows George Takei. He's famous on Facebook, if nothing else. And Rita took a particular shine to him. Although she's going to kill me for saying this. I'll point him out when we eventually see him. But he's up there on the hill with the American troops, who have just taken this hill in Tunisia in 1943. Again, based very, very loosely. Oh, there he is. There he is in the middle. There he is. Hello, George. I'd love to know what your actual name is, because we never got the opportunity to talk. Anyway, where were we? Oh, yes, Tunisia, 1943. So, the US Army saw its first real taste of combat in World War II in the deserts of North Africa, where they didn't do particularly well, but they learned some valuable combat experience that was going to stand them in good stead when it came to the invasion of Sicily, Italy, France, and Germany later on in the war. And that's more or less what this battle reenactment simulates. There was actually a lot of friction in North Africa between the British forces and the American forces. The American forces were there to do a job and win a war. And the British had been fighting the Germans and the Italians in North Africa for a couple of years at that point, and were very keen to share the benefit of their experience with the newly arrived and combat inexperienced American troops. Unfortunately, well, people like Montgomery had a certain way of speaking to the American troops, a very condescending and arrogant way of dealing with them. And that really rubbed the American commanders up the wrong way, in particular, American commanders like George Patton. And this was the source of the infamous rivalry between Patton and Montgomery. And it was largely down to British arrogance, just assuming that the Americans didn't know how to fight because the British had been there for years. And it wasn't necessarily the case, although the American troops were inexperienced at that stage, they did learn a lot of lessons in North Africa, and the way the British Army conducted operations wasn't necessarily going to be the best way for the American Army to do it. And so the Americans had to learn the hard way. But learn they did, and this is more or less what this historical battle reenactment in Tankfest was simulating. And we can see the artillery preparation there, as the Germans prepare for the counterattack in the shape of Rommel's German Africa Corps, which is going to be entering stage right any second now. And here they come, led by Tiger 131 and the Tank Museum's very own Panzer III. And at this point, once again, I think I'm just going to shut up for a bit, crank up the volume, and let you enjoy the show. So, one of the Shermans has been hit and is brewing up, and the American mechanized battalion is being forced to fall back from the hill, which means round one goes to the German Africa Corps. Having taken the hill, the Germans then dig in and prepare for the inevitable counterattack.
Get your heads down!
and it looks like the Americans have made use of their very, very effective artillery to call up an artillery barrage in order to prepare the way for a counterattack courtesy of the British 1st Armoured Division. Thousands of them. Fix bayonets, chaps. They don't like it up 'em. Tiger's been hit and it's brewing up. Looks like the Panzer III is going to have to withdraw under cover of the smoke, and the German casualties are mounting. I was actually standing filming this right next to a bunch of wargaming German EU community contributors, and they were... Can we win this one, please? I mean, come on, Germany, be fair. We've won 2 World Wars and 1 World Cup. You've got 4 World Cups. I mean, I figure you still owe us one. And this German really did not want to get down on the ground. And then again, you can't really blame him, because it had just been raining and it was very, very muddy. Oh, you see that? Mistreatment of prisoners. Easy there, Tommy. Well, that was pretty much it for Tankfest 2016. They had exactly the same show on the Saturday and the Sunday, so it didn't matter which day you turned up, you weren't going to miss anything. And it was just great. I mean, Tankfest always is great. There's a fantastic range and variety of military vehicles and reenactors and historical displays on. It's always worth going, and I never regret it. And, well, it's not the only event that they have at the museum, obviously. There's also Tiger Day, Tank Experience Day, there's the Workshop Experience, and coming on later this year, there's the 100th anniversary of the use of tank in battle for the first time. So keep an eye on the Bovington Tank Museum website for details of future events. Link in the video description. Thank you once again to the museum for putting on a spectacular day. Thank you to Wargaming for once again being the major sponsor and helping to make it all possible. And thank you to everybody who came along and said hello. It was great meeting as many of you as humanly possible. And it was just great being at Tankfest. He's not going to execute that prisoner, is he? No. No. Okay, we're good. Calm down, Tommy. For that, Fritz, the war is definitely over. Anyway, that's it for Tankfest 2016. I hope you enjoyed the video. If you couldn't be there for the day, well, this is going to be at least some kind of compensation for you. And hopefully, you can make it next year. As always, folks, take care, and I'll catch you next time.